So what do you believe to be the primary issue between combining, well, the primary difficulty? What do you believe to be the primary difficulty between combining general relativity and quantum mechanics?
Right. So that's been formulated in many ways. I mean, having just sort of slightly slated Penrose for his for his consciousness views. Let me try and right that wrong a little bit by saying I think Penrose has a really really nice argument for why even just at a conceptual level quantum mechanics and general relativity are incompatible, which is the following: that if you take the two of the most foundational principles, in a sense, delineate, you know, how quantum mechanics is different from classical mechanics and how general relativity is different from classical mechanics. Those would be the superposition principle in quantum mechanics, the principle that if you have a system that can be in, you know, this eigenstate or this eigenstate, it can also be in some complex linear combination of them. And on the side of the Einstein equations of general relativity, it's the principle of equivalence, right? It's the principle that accelerating reference frames and gravitational reference frames are really the same. Or to translate that into slightly more mathematical terms, that you can that anything that appears on the left-hand side of the field equations in the Einstein tensor, you can move as a negative contribution to the right-hand side in the stress-energy tensor. So Penrose has this really nice argument for why those two principles are logically inconsistent. And the argument goes like this, that so suppose that you've got a kind of something like a Schrodinger cat type experiment where you've got, I don't know, you have like a robotic arm that contains a mass at the end that's producing a gravitational field, and it's connected up to radioactive nucleus that has some probability of decaying. So that arm can be in one of two positions. It can be position A, position B, and the position that it's in depends on the quantum state of that nucleus. So now, just naively, what you appear to have done is created a superposition of two different gravitational field configurations. Okay, so if you do that, you can write down a wave equation. You can write down the wave function that corresponds to that superposition, and everything looks just fine. So far, there's no problem. But then, if you believe the equivalence principle, then you should get the same wave function if you then do the same calculation in an accelerating frame. So if you take that whole desktop apparatus and rather than doing it here on the Earth, you do it in a spaceship that's accelerating at 9.81 meters per second squared, okay. And you have exactly the same experimental setup with the same robotic arm. You should get the same wave function. But if you calculate it, which again is just a standard calculation in relativistic quantum mechanics, you get almost the same answer. The two wave functions differ by a phase factor, which normally wouldn't be too much of a problem. Normally, you know, if they differ by a phase factor, you say that they're somehow the same quantum system.
Yes.
But the phase factor depends on time to the power 4. And because of some slightly technical reasons that have to do with the fact that quadratics have two solutions, if you have a phase factor that depends on time to the power 4, that's telling you that the wave function you've written down corresponds to a superposition of two different vacuum states. And one of the core axioms of quantum mechanics is that you can't superpose two different vacuum states for the very simple reason that the vacuum state is the kind of zero point from which you measure energies, you know, using your Hamiltonian. So if you have a superposition of two different vacuum states, there's no longer a uniquely defined Hamiltonian. There's no longer a uniquely defined energy because there's no rule for how you superpose those vacua. So it is inherently illegal in quantum mechanics to produce those superpositions. So somehow by just assuming that you could superpose gravitational fields, you've been able to use the equivalence principle to violate the superposition principle, or equivalently vice versa. There's a more mathematical way of seeing the same thing, which is to say that, okay, so at a very basic level, right, quantum mechanics is linear and has to be linear by the Schrodinger equation. You know, the Schrodinger equation has to be linear because of the superposition principle. So if I have two solutions to the Schrodinger equation, then a complex linear combination of those states with appropriate normalization has to also be a valid solution to the Schrodinger equation. General relativity is nonlinear and has to be nonlinear because, in a sense, if you take the Einstein field equations and you linearize them, you linearize the gravitational interaction, then what you get is a version of general relativity that doesn't possess gravitational self-energy. So in other words, the reason why general relativity is a nonlinear theory is because in Newtonian gravity, if I have a mass, that mass produces a gravitational potential. But the gravitational potential doesn't produce a gravitational potential. But in general relativity, because of the mass-energy equivalence, I have a mass that produces a gravitational potential, but that gravitational potential has some energy associated to it. So it also produces a gravitational field, and that produces another gravitational field, and so on. So there's actually a whole infinite sort of set of these smaller gravitational fields that are being produced. So this is often summarized as the by the slogan that gravity gravitates. And that appears as a non-linear contribution to the Einstein field equations, as these off-diagonal terms that appear in the Einstein tensor. And so it has to be non-linear, because if you were to take two solutions to the Einstein equations, two metrics, and just try and add them together, you quite clearly wouldn't get a third solution to the Einstein equations in general, because what you've done is you've added the gravitational potentials, which is really what the metric tensors are indicating, but you haven't incorporated all these additional nonlinear contributions induced by the sum of the gravitational potentials themselves. So the basic problem is that you can't superpose gravitational fields, right? And that's really what the Penrose argument is kind of indicating, that if I try and take two metric tensors and just add them in a way that's consistent with the Schrödinger equation, I'll violate the Einstein field equations. And if I try and take two solutions to the Einstein field equations and combine them in a nonlinear way that's compatible with general relativity, I'll violate the linearity of the Schrödinger equation. And at some level, that's the basic problem, right? The problem is that the linearity of Schrödinger versus the nonlinearity of Einstein means that superpositions of gravitational fields cannot be described without violating at least one of those two formalisms.
Does the conceptual difficulty still persist in the quantizing linearized general relativity?
So my understanding is that you can certainly get further with quantizing linearized. So if you just linearize your gravitational interaction, you can not only evolve quantum fields on top of a curved spacetime described in terms of linearized gravity, which you can do for Einstein gravity, but you can also describe the back reaction of the quantum fields onto the metric tensor. I actually don't know how much further than that you can go. I suspect, but what I do know is that it's definitely a lot easier. You can make much more rapid progress with quantizing gravity if you assume linearizations than if you don't. I think there are still some problems that persist, but I think they're nowhere near as difficult.
So how is it that higher category theory overcomes this?
That's a great question. The basic answer is I don't know, but there's a very tempting kind of hypothesis, right? So I mentioned towards the beginning that there are these category theoretic models for quantum mechanics, and also I think I mentioned briefly that there are these models for quantum field theory as well. And the way that works is, so we talked at the start about these, you know, Dagger symmetric compact closed monoidal categories, which are the kind of the basic mathematical setup for categorical quantum mechanics. The problem with that, though, is that every time you apply one of these morphisms, every time you apply one of these time evolution operators, you are essentially picking out a preferred direction of time, right? You are assuming you've got, you know, if you imagine each of your quantum each of your spaces of states is a space of states on a particular space-like hypersurface. Once you construct a unitary evolution operator that's a solution to the Schrödinger equation, you are selecting a preferred direction of time, which is of course not relativistic. That's not covariant. So to go from the non-relativistic version of quantum mechanics to a version that's compatible at least with Lorentz symmetry, you need to have some systematic way of transforming one time direction to another. Well, if you think about it in the category theoretic perspective, through the category theoretic lens, there's a systematic way to do that, which is through higher categories. So if you consider categories which have, you know, objects and morphisms, you can also consider two categories that have two morphisms between those morphisms that allow you to transform morphisms to each other, not just objects to each other. And so if you take the two category version of the one category picture of categorical quantum mechanics, you can allow the two categories to correspond to gauge transformations between your evolution operators. So you're transforming the direction of time in a way that's consistent with, say, with the generators of the Lorentz group. And so what you get in some appropriate special case is is what's called a functorial quantum field theory. So Baez and Dolan constructed this axiomatization of functorial and particularly topological quantum field theories based on what's called a Tia-Siegel axiomatization that used these two categories and indeed even higher categories as a way of formalizing this notion of gauge transformations, of being able to transform between time directions. Okay, so that's a nice piece of mathematics. And in my opinion, is one of the more promising avenues towards constructing a kind of mathematically rigorous foundation for quantum field theory. What does it have to do with quantum gravity? Well, this is where it necessarily becomes very speculative. But so there's an idea that goes back to Alexander Grothendieck, who I mentioned, you know, this amazing algebraic geometer from the early 20th century, who really developed a whole bunch of these ideas from applied in higher category theory while he was sort of living as a basically a hermit in the Pyrenees, I think. But so Grothendieck made this hypothesis that's now called Grothendieck's hypothesis or the homotopy hypothesis, which goes as follows. Oh, okay, let me motivate it like this. So if I have a topological space, it has some collection of points and it has paths that connect those points. But I can also have paths that connect the paths, and those are called homotopies, right? So I can continuously deform one path into another, and I can use that information to tell me stuff about the topology of the space. So, you know, you can use the homotopy information to tell you about the homology, right? You can find that there's a, if you're in a donut, you can see that there's a hole there, because if you have a loop, a path that loops around that hole, you can't continuously contract it to a point without encountering some discontinuity. Those homotopies you can formalize as, you know, kind of higher order paths between paths. So in the language of category theory, you could say my initial topological space is a one category that has points and, you know, paths between them, objects and morphisms. The first homotopy type is the two category I construct from that, where the two morphisms are the homotopies between those paths. But then I can also consider homotopies between the homotopies and so on. So I can construct this whole hierarchy of higher categories and higher homotopy types. And then that terminates at this infinity category level, which is the hierarchy has some natural endpoint, and the somehow we know that from various results in higher category theory that the information, all the information that you care about up to weak homotopy equivalence about not just the space you started from, but all of the intermediate spaces that were in that hierarchy, all of that information is somehow contained in the algebraic structure of that infinity category. So okay. The infinity category determines up to weak homotopy equivalence everything that comes in the hierarchy below it. And that's why kind of infinity category theory is so different to even just normal finite higher category theory. Infinity categories somehow contain far more information. There's actually a specific type of infinity category called an infinity groupoid because because the paths are invertible, right? And Grothendieck was one of the first people who encouraged topologists to stop thinking about fundamental groups and start thinking about fundamental groupoids without needing to define distinguished base points and things like that. But the homotopy hypothesis is this really deep statement that kind of goes in the other direction, where so we know that starting from a space and doing this hierarchical construction, you build up to this infinity category that tells you, you know, up to weak homotopy equivalence, all the topological information about that space and all of its homotopy types. Grothendieck then said, well, maybe that's really the definition of a topological space, that infinity categories are just spaces. Infinity groupoids are spaces, or at least they define the structure of a space and all of its homotopy types up to weak homotopy equivalence. So it's kind of the converse direction of that statement. And that's the homotopy hypothesis. It's not proven. It's not even precisely formulated, but it's a very interesting idea that I think is largely believed to be correct, right? It aligns well with our intuitions for how algebraic topology should work. So therefore, attempting speculation about the relationship between that and physics, so going back to the quantum field theory picture for a moment. So suppose you don't just stop at two categories or indeed three categories, but you keep going, right? You keep adding these higher gauge transformations, gauge transformations that deform time direction to time direction, but higher gauge transformations that deform gauge transformation to gauge transformation. You build up a higher homotopy type that way. What happens when you get to the infinity category limit? Well, so what you end up with is something that has the structure of a topological space. So you starting from something that's completely non-spatial, you've ended up with a topological space. In the spirit of these kind of emergent space-time views, you know, like ER equals EPR and so on, one hypothesis that's quite tempting to make is maybe that infinity category defines the structure of our space-time, right? The topology and geometry of space-time emerges in that infinity category limit that I take by just adding higher and higher gauge transformations starting from categorical quantum mechanics. And so if that's true, which, again, to be clear, we have no idea whether that's true or not, right? But if that were true, then the coherence conditions, the conditions that define how the infinity category relates to all of the lower categories in that hierarchy, those coherence conditions would essentially be an algebraic parameterization for possible quantum gravity models. Mm-hmm. And so that would be if that ended up being correct, that would be a really nice way to kind of conceptualize and formalize the essential problem of quantum gravity, that we're really trying to nail down the coherence conditions that relate that infinity category to all the higher categories in that hierarchy.
The Economist covers math, physics, philosophy, and AI in a manner that shows how different countries perceive developments and how they impact markets. They recently published a piece on China's new neutrino detector. They cover extending life via mitochondrial transplants, creating an entirely new field of medicine. But it's also not just science. They analyze culture. They analyze finance, economics, business, international affairs across every region. I'm particularly liking their new insider feature. It was just launched this month. It gives you, it gives me, a front row access to The Economist's internal editorial debates, where senior editors argue through the news with world leaders and policymakers in twice weekly long format shows. Basically, an extremely high quality podcast. Whether it's scientific innovation or shifting global politics, The Economist provides comprehensive coverage beyond headlines. As a Toll listener, you get a special discount. Head over to economist.com/TOE to subscribe. That's economist.com/TOE for your discount.